Got a package unit here that's not working. And then we have a compressor to replace.
The air conditioner comes in across the ceiling.
Got a fan blade that's broke. Can't help but notice this little problem. Yeah, that's not normal. Man, oh man, you got all these freaking things I gotta do today and I ain't got time for all this. No super heat, that ain't good.
That's not good.
Just found this, that's gonna cause some problems. Should be out of defrost.
Whoa.
What is going on? And it's literally 5:30. I'm beyond ready to leave.
This video is brought to you in part by TrueTech Tools. Quality tools, essential support.
All right, so I'm back again today, Friday, 10:30-ish. Let's go ahead and get started on this. I feel like a total idiot. I wasn't thinking. I should have checked the amp draw of my compressor when I pulled Y1 or Y2 off and seen if it made a difference. Let's do that and see what's going on. On the good side of things, it just pumped down and shut off. I don't see no oil. Nothing's leaking. That's doing good. This one here is still running. A lot of heat coming out. Sight glass is still full. Fan blade will be in later today, which does me no good, but we probably need to come back anyhow for that condensate pan thing. Here's the winter start accessory. That is bypassing the low pressure switch, and it is powered with a time delay relay. So that thing I removed yesterday, I got to put that back on. Here is the CS2V, which is a cooling stage 2 valve, and then CS2VR, which is the relay, I believe. And here's the LDR. LDR is your compressor loader internal. So that's powered off 3 and 6 on the compressor 2 section here of the board. This one here is powered off of the relay there, so it's kind of screwy the way they got it. But anyhow, let's go ahead and check that compressor, see if it's load, unload. The DC plug conversion. So we got AC power coming down, and it is literally converted at the compressor. Hot on top, not so much down here. We're not even freezing up with the cover off. Enough talking, let's check that and see what the amperage does. So we're at 16 amps area. Check each individual leg. This is 3-phase, yet all the legs are not equal. But there we are at 15 something. Let's go ahead and unhook Y2. Pull it out, and look at that. It's not changing. Okay, hear that click? So what that does is you got to click there. You can hear the solenoid changing. 23, 22 volts, so it is energizing. So we are getting the power down here. Polarity's wrong, but not a big deal. It'll be right when I put it on there. So let's get this back on the compressor. So we are 20 amps now on the yellow. Let's take that off here on the top and change. And it changed back down. I did not hear that yesterday. Tell you what, let's get our probes on there or gauges, whatever, and we'll see where we're at. Okay, we've got our probes hooked up. Yes, we have the cover off. Head pressure is going to be higher because we are not moving air through the coil right now because it's completely coming through this container right here. I understand that. We're running a nice suction there. It's 37 degrees. We're running basically the same pressures we ran yesterday, and we're actually cooler today. I'm going to say we're probably, if you're lucky, 75, 72 versus the 80 or whatever it was yesterday. So we're going to let that cool down and get us a measurement on that. Let's go ahead and energize this thing and see what it does now. You can hear it change. Look at that. It's going up. It did not do that the other day. We are jumped into Y2. Compressor says we're in it because we're pulling 21 amps. Yesterday I was checking the amperage on that solenoid because it's DC, even though it's rectified, it does not show up. So for whatever reason, it's such low current, it's not showing up. I don't know if we can wrap it a few times, see if it changes. There, I wrapped it through there, total of 3 passes, and it's still not enough to show up. I could grab my other meter and see what the actual amp draw is on it, but for whatever reason, it's working though. That's the whole thing. We've got the solenoid over there. You can see it's jumping when I power it. It's doing its thing at half an amp. We're not having the same issues with the suction that I had yesterday. It's just wild. So yesterday when I took the door off, the temperature dropped to 25 degrees. today it's not. As you figure, we undo it. Should pump that refrigerant back to it. There goes our suction, because if you're not pumping heavily, you're not pushing, you're not pulling. You ain't pulling, your suction's gonna stay higher. And it's coming back up. It's totally not doing what it did yesterday. I think I'm gonna go ahead and put that bypass back on for the low pressure switch, as much as I, you know, gotta admit I hadn't seen that used before, but whatever, we'll put that on there. So we're nice and straight. I just took it a couple more turns. We're nowhere near our max. So now the belt has still got a little bit of room. It's a little tight, but yeah, it's, I don't really want to go a lot more. One more would probably max it completely out. Let's see where that's at. All right, so 6.7, max out of 208 volts is 8.8. We're still fine there on that. Got a little bit of a shake. Might need to loosen that up just a touch. We've realigned, we've loosened it up a little bit. I repositioned my tack strip there on the dry pulley so I can get true RPM. I think I was doing it wrong. Also, if you think about it, these are not obviously a one-to-one ratio. So let's put the tack strip completely straight up and down here on the right. Let's go ahead and put a mark over here on this pulley here, straight up and down. Watch what happens when we turn this. The one on the right has completely made one rotation. This one hasn't, obviously. For people that love this kind of thing, they're gonna know that that's no kidding, duh. But it's gonna spin slower here, obviously. So I think I was doing it in the wrong spot. Let's recheck, see where we're at. It's rated for 1725 according to the nameplate. Let's see where we're at there. And in theory, probably should be at the very end. I don't usually check RPMs very often unless we really need to get it back to a specific thing that, say, somebody balanced it, they need to change it, and we need to get it back. That was kind of the only reason why I bought it, other than the fact that I was working on a makeup air unit and I needed it. So it's not every day I use this freaking thing for checking RPMs, but I got it. I've tried it on multiple different motors, and it's pretty dang accurate for a no-namer. Got my one there, got my other one there, a little scrap piece, hopefully it'll stick. There we go. Look at that, 1721, 1720, 1722. So we're running right at that 1725 area. About 934, 935. Yesterday I think we had just 900, so I got 35 more RPMs out of it on that piece. So anyhow, to loosen that up, it's not rattling the whole unit now, even with the blower door off. There's your 8.3, so now we're loading it down pretty hard. So we're definitely starved a little bit for return. Door on. 6.3. Didn't even change. Don't remember what I said. I don't think it changed by much. About makes me go that last turn for giggles. It only had one more turn out of it anyway, if that. It's maxed out. See what it made difference here on this or not. 955, so it made about 20 more different 20 more revolutions, and with the door off, we're still running 1720 area. Before the door, 8.4, still not maxed out. Door back on, 6.7 6.6. So let's see how it does now. We got the low pressure switch time delay bypass back on there. That, like I said, it's on the schematic down there. We got it for right around about a minute area. That allows it time to build up pressure, suction pressure, when it's really super cold out. It's in parallel, so it's on the normally closed contacts. When you receive a Y1 signal, it goes through the time delay. It's a delay on make. So once that delay exceeds that time, it sends 24 volts then to the coil. Common's going up to here, the colors match, so it's easy to follow. It's going to power it, which is going to open it because it's in the normally closed position here on the relay, and then it'll remove it, and then you'll still have your safeties, but you won't have a false trip in the cold weather when the refrigerant pressure and stuff is low. That gives it time, like I said, to build up pressure. So that's what that is. Live and learn, guys. You learn something all the time. I'm not too not afraid to say that, hey, I make mistakes and didn't know about it. And that's the whole point of doing this. I don't make these videos to say that I know how to do everything. It's just sharing what I'm doing, and you guys enjoy watching it, great. You know, I like hearing that it's helped some people out there learn from my mistakes and kind of move on. Anybody that knows everything is probably lying. Let's go ahead and kick it back on and see what we got. See what our pressure is now that we got a little more airflow. We restarted it. We're in low right now. We're running 11 and a half superheat, 9 or so subcooling. Pressures are very similar. The evaporator temperature is a lot higher now, if you notice that, running a 40 degree, which is beautiful. It is 76 on the wall in there. It rose in temperature pretty quick. The stat was also kind of programmed to have a little more of a swing between first and second than I care for, and I usually like to get close to set point versus lingering in the zone between first and second. Personal preference. I know that a lot of people want to run it forever. Commercial, I like to get it on, get it off, and get it done. Everybody's got their own preference. We're only saving 3 amps of current comfort wise. It's probably going to run nonstop anyway because the people have everything doors open anyhow. So we've got that on low. Let's see what it does on high.
There we go.
Of course, you know, the fan shuts off over there because the pressure dropped when the coil opened up. So there it came, should have came back on. Looks like it is good. Head jumped for a little bit, and let's see where she settles out at. It really does not seem to make that humongous of a difference to it. I think it's just all playing with numbers to make the government agencies happy. Honestly do. More things to go wrong later, but hey, as long as it looks good on paper.
Here's the other walk-in cooler thing I was talking about. That infamous drain heater there tends to leak like crazy. It is low again already, so either change it today or at least recharge it and get it going so we can get back.
We're about 80 degrees out here. We're running 95 on high speed, so we're about 15 over ambient. Running 36 on our saturated temperature. This is in high, like I said. In low, I had 284 and 118, which is, I think, 39 degrees. And 92 degrees on my liquid suction. So I mean, everything is looking so much better, even with the more fan speed. I gotta take a temp drop there. I'm bouncing back and forth just like I did yesterday, so I'm gonna add a little bit of refrigerant to that freezer because I gotta come back and replace this fan blade here anyhow. You can see that that thing is cracked right there, but it'll be fine until I get back. Then it also gave me a chance to double check this. Made sure that, you know, everything's good on HVAC here for the weekend.
Looks like we got her solid there. Added about 14 ounces. So that'll be good enough to get us for over the weekend, if not a week before we get back. Just depends. I mean, that blade is going to be here today, but now we can do it at our convenience to come back. It's supposed to be hot next week. Luckily today, it's not too bad.
We're still in high. I got to tighten up that screw terminal yet. Let's pull this off and see if it gets stupid again. Remember last time it dropped to 25 pounds or 25 degree suction with the cover off, which made really very little sense. This thing runs so cool that it's just not normal. It does not appear to be. Maybe we just were not moving enough airflow. I'm gonna take a temp drop across the duct, see where we're at on that.
So we're right at, let's just say 70 degrees.
And what do we hear? Okay, that kind of sucks. 65.6. I wonder if we're down to one stage. Yep, it just shut off. That figures. We're here today to replace the condensate coil here. Got a new filter dryer in. Did a test on it, and we're trying out the new 557S test tube gauges here. And it says I've got a leak. You can see it dropping pretty quickly there. Now it's starting to slow down some. But checked all my solder joints, brace joints, whatever, and go down here on the compressor. And sure enough, you can see it leaking right there on that bolt on the back end of it. So, yep, we got a leak.
All right, guys, we're gonna go ahead and end the video out here because I didn't record anything further.
I can explain a couple of things that I think happened as I'm going through and editing the video. One, I think the thermostat, because they had like a 2 degree or more differential, plus there were some other tricks into that Vinstar stat that they've got in there. It was playing games, kicking up, kicking down. Airflow was a huge issue, which is why my suction was so low. Secondly, I thought I was in high stage, and a couple times I think that thermostat screwed me and went on to single stage. I should have just jumped it, the unit with my jumper cable. That way I know for sure. I think it was kicking in and out. I didn't even know it. So I think that was a lot of my goofiness with my pressures. Some of that also, like I said, a good majority of it, I would say a good majority of it was just my airflow was just too low in the cooling mode. Now, as far as the walk-in freezer there, that was also a part that someone else found bad. I went back and installed it. That coil was leaking really bad, so I don't think they picked up the other leak on the compressor. I was able to tighten that bolt. You got to remember also, I'm running a nitrogen test of about 175 pounds, whereas normally that thing's running at, you know, 25 to 45 area because it's running 404. So that was a really tiny leak, and it would have never been found without having the nitrogen on the system. I was able to tighten it up, like I said, and it worked fine. Other than that, I haven't been back to this place. As you might have noticed in the beginning, this was June 9th of last month. So today is July 3rd, and that was back on June 9th, the first trip, June 10th on the second trip. And then when I went back for the condensate loop there, I was back a few days after that. They hadn't had any more problems. There was no more ice on the coil. So I'm confident that everything's working fine like it should. We haven't had to go back. It's been well over a month area now, or soon to be a month. And that's about it, guys. I appreciate you watching both videos. If you didn't see the first one, you definitely want to go back and get things put into context. If you guys would, please check us out on Instagram and Facebook. And until next time, we'll catch you on the next one. Happy 4th of July. Later.